This is TWiT.
I'm glad that you brought up that the vignette about how he always had the answers, because that's that research that came into play. In fact, if you switch, Carson, to my screen here, there was this scene early in the episode, first episode of the screenplay, the adaptation of the books, where you're showing, now this could be a throwaway scene to non-geeks, but geeks look at this, and this was the first indication I had of they're going to take this seriously. You know, they've actually gone through the process of understanding how the physics would work on a spinning body that's trying to generate artificial gravity via centripetal force or centrifugal force. And when I saw this, I said, okay, I'm going to like this. And I think it was the same thing for most of fandom. We've got Specs in our chat room who's saying there's a delicious realism, even though I know that all of this is fanciful, there's a delicious realism that keeps me close enough to how I know physics works that makes me buy into the story so much more. Is that all the result of this research?
A great deal of that is the result of Ty's research and of Ty's dedication to not phoning in the science. And it's been something that we've struggled with. We've had generations of science fiction on television and in movies that has educated us incorrectly. So that even when we get it right now, it looks weird. And trying to get close, trying to get that plausibility, has been really hard. It's been really tricky, and it's made, I think, a show that has a different feel than anything else. Just because you are reminded over and over that it's not magic.
Right. And I think that's one of the things that hooked me. After the first series, I was completely hooked because there was no magic tech. I think the closest you get to magic tech is probably the Epstein drive and the juice that keeps me from turning into a puddle at high G's. Other than that, I mean, it's not, as you mentioned, it's not what I expect from sci-fi. There's no artificial gravity. There's no warp drive that instantly gets me from one place to the next. There's no transporters. There's no magical material that can survive being hit by a micrometeoroid at millions of kilometers an hour.
And there's no shields.
Exactly. And the weaponry they use on the series, it's, I can imagine it, rail guns, Gatling guns and missiles. Okay, yeah, we've got those. But it makes it harder to make sci-fi when you're trying to be real, right? I mean, it would be so much easier if you could add one or two elements of traditional space sci-fi and say, yeah, we don't have to worry about taking a shuttle from the ship to the station because I just transport over.
It makes it different. But part of what defines the feeling about any project, show, book, story, whatever, is the choice of obstacles. If you have no obstacles at all, it's going to be a terrible story. That's just if the rules can be anything for every scene, then it's terrible. So by choosing the obstacles, by choosing a different set of obstacles than the usual, it does mean we have to think things through. It does mean sometimes we have to chew things out that we wouldn't have had to do if we'd done something more familiar. But it also means we get things that nobody else has gotten to do because we have other things to work around. Mark Ferguson, Hawk Ospe, who wrote the pilot and who really launched this whole thing, the guys who did Iron Man and Children of Men, were talking about light delay because we have light delay in the show. If something's going on Jupiter and you're on Earth, you're 40 minutes behind to start. And they were talking about how cell phones have destroyed the thriller genre because everybody can just call and tell people what's going on anytime they want to. It's hard to have that tension of withheld information. And light delay gives you some part of that back because something is going on and you need to get information to them. And it is physically impossible for that information to arrive until maybe the whole thing's already been decided. So that's something narratively we get back.
Right. Let me go a bit more into the realism of the show, because there was this one scene, I was actually looking for it right now, in season 2, Doors and Corners, where they're no spoilers for the people who haven't watched it yet or not up to date, but there's a battle. There are several battles, but in this particular battle, you're doing a zero-G battle, and we actually see projectiles coming through the ship. And for a moment there was this, why are they doing that? The conversation in the back of my head, as you see sort of the hot fragments just sort of staying where they are. And I said, oh, yeah, that makes sense. If you were in zero G, the particles would just hang there until you applied acceleration. That's one of those moments where it makes me wonder, was that something you always had in mind? Was that something that the special effects guys just threw together? Or do you consider those moments a crucial part of the story where it really brings the audience into, I'm experiencing this for real?
It's an aesthetic that we've chosen for the show that the whole team is in on now. I mean, I don't know if that idea originated with Ty. I imagine it would, or if it came from the VFX guys who have really invested a lot of time and energy in thinking about and understanding this, or in our showrunner, Naren Shankar, who's, he's got a PhD in engineering and all of this is scratching his itch too. But at this point, everybody who is playing this game with us, everybody who's involved in this project, has started looking for those moments, has started thinking about those moments, and has started trying to find ways to incorporate them into the show because it's what makes us us.